Macmillan Audio presents Guardians of the Trees, A Journey of Hope Through Healing the Planet by Kinari Webb, MD. Read for you by Suehyla, El-Attar, with an introduction from the author. To my child, who is such an unexpected blessing in my later years and is being born just as this audiobook is.
A note on names, translations, and events. Throughout this book, with a few exceptions, I use the traditional Indonesian method of addressing people, an honorific plus their first name. Most of the honorifics used are family terms, which are applied to the entire community as a traditional courtesy. For example, any man who has had children will be called Pak, which means father, and similarly, a woman will be called Ibu, meaning mother. A woman who does not have children is called Tanta, which means auntie, and this was how it was often referred to outside the clinic before I had a child. In the clinic and in official settings, I am called Dr. Kinari, or affectionately Dr. K. A young person is addressed using sibling terms that indicate their relative age, mba or ka, older sister, bang, older brother, and adik, younger sibling. In Indonesia, in guessing someone's age, you should guess on the older side because it honors them more, even though people may collapse in laughter if you get it wrong. Only if you are very, very close to someone can you use their name without any honorific at all. So I have not used an honorific for people I consider to be my close friend. In quoting a conversation with an Indonesian, I have generally given only the English translation, even though, unless otherwise noted, these conversations were in Indonesian. The translations are my own and are sometimes slightly loose so that the meaning is clear. I have used people's real names where appropriate, but I have changed the names of patients unless they gave me specific permission to share their stories. In some cases, I have changed the person's gender or other details to preserve their anonymity. In one case, I combined two meetings for clarity, but all other events are described as they occurred.
When you live in the forest, it's easy to see that everything's connected. Dr. Jane Goodall.
Preface. Growing up in northern New Mexico, I shared a horse, Pinto, with one of our neighbors. One day, Pinto and I were cantering along the mesa top when he saw something. I don't know what it was, but he reared straight up and pivoted around. If you have ever heard the term runaway horse, it's real. Pinto laid his ears back and full out galloped straight for the edge of the mesa. I knew for certain that we would both die if we went over the edge. But Pinto was not responding to the reins, no matter what I tried. If I jumped off, neither of us would survive. Seconds from disaster, I remembered something I once read, that it is impossible for a horse to run with something hanging from its neck. So I swung both feet over to the same stirrup, grabbed his mane with my right hand, and swung myself down under his neck at full gallop, gripping his mane on both sides. Pinto slid to a stop just feet from the edge of the cliff, saving both our lives. That day with Pinto taught me an important lesson. Even when things look hopeless, it might still be possible to avoid disaster. This book is about my own work on what feels like the biggest cliff any of us could possibly face. The danger that our Earth will no longer be livable for us. Global warming is happening faster than even the worst models predicted 10 years ago. We are only beginning to understand just how dangerous the feedback loops can be. As reflective ice disappears, polar seas absorb sunlight and warm more quickly, and melting tundra releases methane into the atmosphere. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change has said that if we don't have carbon emissions by 2030, we may go beyond irreversible tipping points, at which time it won't matter what we do. In other words, that cliff is very close. When most people think about emissions, they usually think only about burning fossil fuels for cars, airplanes, and electricity. They don't realize that deforestation releases as much carbon as the entire transportation sector for the whole world. Despite covering only 2% of the surface of the Earth, rainforests support 50% of the world's species and hold 25% of the world's carbon, stored in both the trees and the soil. In addition, as trees grow, they continue to suck down carbon from the atmosphere. Trees, and especially tropical rainforest trees, are our absolute best friends in halting the climate crisis, since they absorb a third of the pollution we emit every year. They are the natural climate solution, exquisitely invented through millions of years of evolution. Rainforests are huge banks of carbon, and the bigger the tree, the more carbon it absorbs as it grows and the more oxygen it releases. Forests are for this reason sometimes referred to as the lungs of the earth. When forest is logged or burned, most of that carbon gets released into the atmosphere, and the local cooling effects of the trees are lost as well. We do have to transition our world to one powered by alternative energies, but we also have to protect the tropical rainforests of the world, because even if we stopped releasing more carbon, we would need the forest's help to get the Earth's atmosphere back into a safer balance. No humans in all of human existence have lived through a time like this. Can we stop this runaway horse before we tumble off the cliff? Can we find a way to live sustainably and in balance with our planet? Is it possible for that transformation to be unexpected and profound? For more than a decade, I've had the privilege to lead a tiny band of people resisting the loss of biodiversity and the poisoning of our earth, serving as a doctor who heals both people and nature. I founded two organizations that support this work from different sides of the earth: Health and Harmony in the United States, and Alam Sehat Lestari in Indonesia. The Indonesian name translates to healthy nature, everlasting, and the short form, Asri, means harmoniously balanced. I have had the incredible joy of partnering with my Indonesian colleagues as they transcended poor education, lack of opportunity, and a culture of fatalism to create a multi-award-winning model that honors the local communities as the wisdom holders for how to reverse rainforest loss and improve human well-being. I hope this story will inspire and motivate you to join in this movement across the planet to bring about change. By listening to rainforest communities and partnering around the world, we can have huge impacts on the health of the whole planet. By working together, we can thrive.
1. Death and the Sun. Sukadana, West Kalimantan, Indonesia, July 2011. On the equator, dusk falls so quickly it often leaves me feeling bereft. Though the sun sets an orange glow of the light make up in brilliance what they lack in length. One night in July 2011, my husband, Cam, and I were swimming in the warm waters of the South China Sea, watching the sunset from the special cove where we retreated most evenings. We couldn't see a single dwelling, although it was only about 10 minutes' walk along a sparse path to the thatched roof house that had become our home in the little town of Sukadana in Indonesian Borneo. Silvered leaf monkeys chattered in the patch of mangrove behind us, competing with the cacophony of forest insects. One peak of the mountain chain of Gunung Palung National Park rose high above the mangroves, shrouded in wisps of mist and appearing deceptively close. The low clouds began to be lit by bits of pink, and a pair of sea eagles called to each other overhead. I found myself unexpectedly content. It was the perfect ending to a long day of caring for patients in the crowded clinic. I had helped open the clinic 4 years earlier as part of a conservation project designed to improve people's health as the key to saving rainforest. This was a dream I had conceived 18 years prior, about 20 miles from this very spot, deep in the forest where Cam and I first met, when I was studying orangutans on the western side of Indonesian Borneo. Cam had continued his research in ecology, striving to understand the complexities of tree species diversity in these magnificent forests. I, on the other hand, had taken a new direction, to become a physician, one who believed deeply that unless both the environment and the people are healthy, neither can be. And now I was beginning to see, with great joy, that this ambitious strategy was no longer a fragile and untested idea for me, but a solid success. In just 4 years, the staff had grown from the original 8 to more than 60 dedicated individuals, and we were already seeing dramatic drops in illegal logging, in addition to impressive improvements in community health. As Cam and I paddled and splashed, enjoying that golden sunset, I was suddenly overwhelmed by searing pain. My right hand reacted even before my brain was conscious of what was happening. I grabbed at the rubbery tentacles that coiled around my left arm and down my back, where they curled into the scoop of my bathing suit. When I pulled at the lashes, they stung my hand fiercely, but I didn't let go. Every fiber of my being knew that my life depended on getting them off me. I was scrambling backward toward the shore, screaming, frantic. Neither of us saw the jellyfish, but we both knew that was the only thing it could be. Reaching the shallow water, I grabbed sand and scrubbed the sting, but that just seemed to make it worse. What were you supposed to do for these toxins? Vinegar, urine? The excruciating pain felt like hundreds of wasp stings, so anything was worth a try. I looked up at my husband, who had just caught up with me. Cam, can you pee on me? He obligingly whipped it out, while I crouched in the shallow waves, and nothing happened. Hurry, Cam, I think I'm going to pass out. I'm sorry, it's just not that easy to pee on your wife. When it finally did happen, it wasn't pleasant, nor was there any noticeable change in the fierce pain. Staggering out of the water and sloshing myself clean, I gave Cam the few instructions I could think of. He wasn't a medical doctor, but he was one of the most intelligent people I had ever met, and he had seen me through medical school. If I lose consciousness, carry me to the house and give me a shot with the EpiPen. I told him to call the two doctors I had been training and quickly ticked off the medicines they should give me. Every step of the walk home, I doubted I would make it, but somehow I got there. We tried squeezing lime juice on the sting, and then I did the one thing you should never do. I went into our little lean-to bathroom and scooped cold water out of the half-rusted 50-gallon drum and poured it over my body. The water ran off my skin and down through the wide-spaced plank floor and onto the ground below. I began to scrub the line of welts with soap, but before I could even finish, I started shaking from head to foot. I could feel the waves of toxin flowing through my veins as the fresh water triggered the popping of thousands of tiny nematocysts, perfect microscopic balloons of poison, each equipped with a tiny syringe injecting death. My heart subliminally told me that it was about to stop. As a physician, I found this fascinating. Ah, patients know when their heart is about to fail. I could barely breathe, choking and moaning, in indescribable pain. I stumbled back into the house where Cam caught me as I fell to the floor. Working in a place with minimal pain medication and almost non-existent health services, I have seen pain. Lots of pain. But I had never seen anyone acting the way I was acting, except sometimes women in the last pushes of childbirth. But this was different. Intense fear was layered on top, because I knew my heart was moments from pumping its last pump. People in the village had warned us not to swim in the sea because of the umpai. We knew the word meant jellyfish, but we thought they meant the familiar moon jellies, whose small stings were an irritating but minor nuisance. So, stupidly, I had not listened to them and had swum in that bay probably more than 1,000 times. Now I got it. They must have meant box jellyfish, whose toxin is the deadliest thing on the planet. The firebombs exploding in every muscle could come from nothing else. No wonder they had warned us. Cam scrambled through the storage containers until he found the syringe he was looking for. He plunged the EpiPen into my thigh so hard I knew it would leave a large bruise, if I survived. The epinephrine flooded into my body. Half a second later, I felt my heart leap. I held my breath as a sense of relief reached my brain. At least the cardiac part of the toxin wouldn't win at that moment. But every nerve in my body told me this battle was only beginning. Cam used his phone to Google box jellyfish and discovered that their venom is 100 times stronger than that of the king cobra we had once had in our kitchen. How could I possibly survive this? Many hours later, it was 2 a.m., and at least 50 people were crowded with me in the clinic. Most of us, including myself, were sure I would die. The action of the neurologic part of the toxin was bringing every muscle in my body to contractions that felt like a 7 on a scale of 10. Every muscle. Then, one after another, each went to the maximum contraction of 10. The perfect outline could be traced beneath the skin where my muscles stood out in the most excruciating cramp one could imagine. Each one was horribly painful when it fully contracted, but the absolute worst and most dangerous was the diaphragm. With the diaphragm in spasm, one cannot breathe. And that was what was happening to me. I pursed my lips against the pain, trying desperately to suck in a tiny bit of air. I writhed almost constantly, no position tolerable. In lucid moments, I wished for an anatomy book. Muscles I only dimly recalled from medical school would announce themselves in a visible outline and leave me crying. When the one that controls the tiniest bone in the body, the stapes bone in the inner ear, sent out stabbing pain, it was all I could do to keep from screaming. We administered 4 times the maximum dose of every pain medication we had in our pharmacy. The wonderful young doctors I had trained were too scared to give me more than that for fear of killing me. I knew they were right, even as I struggled to breathe. I looked at my left arm, welted from the stings. I very seriously considered amputating it. We had the tools to do it. It would have to be done without anesthesia, but given the 9 out of 10 pain I was already in, 10 out of 10 felt worth it. I decided not to amputate, though, only because the venom had clearly already spread throughout my whole body. Evacuation insurance was one of the benefits of being an adjunct faculty member at the Yale School of Medicine, but the nearest runway was 2 hours away, and it only operated during daylight. Besides, as we learned from an internet search on the clinic's satellite connection, there was no Western medical treatment for this jellyfish venom anyway. The only thing I could think of that a hospital could do would be to paralyze me and put me on a ventilator. That honestly sounded pretty good, but given that every hour had increased the pain, I doubted I would make it to dawn. As word went out that I was dying, more and more people gathered. First, about 20 staff members arrived, and gradually around 30 people from the community showed up in the middle of the night. People's attention soon focused on an argument about potential treatment options. The son of a Chinese shopkeeper in town, whose own life we had saved dramatically twice, was disagreeing with Ibu Ateng, the traditional massage healer to whom we often referred patients. "The fisherman who was stung last year only got about this much of the tentacle on him." Ibu Ateng indicated the first joint of her thumb about 1 inch. "But he was in the hospital for 4 days. He screamed and cried the whole time in spite of all the pain medication. How is Dr. Kinari going to survive when she got the tentacle all the way up her arm and all the way down her back? Plus, she..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.